thing on here is the voice of experience, by the way. I'm jealous of seeing the guys that are at the start of their journey. I think I'm kind of more on the down ramp than the upright in my hand career. I've spent my whole life, actually. I started in the industry in 1982 on the help desk in a construction computing company. And my last gig was president of Textura, which Oracle kindly bought from us for $663 million. Give a nod to a point made earlier. Also interestingly, Aconex acquired my previous business, which was called Conject. Sadly, Aconex got acquired for $1.2 billion, and we sold Conject for €65 million, which I thought was great at the time, but in hindsight, it doesn't look quite so good. Anyways, I'm on my second wife, by the way, so I actually need the cash. So, if only I'd have known about the kind of prenuptial thing that does. Can save so much money, so much misery. So I'm going to start by saying a lot of what I'm seeing and hearing right now, I've seen and heard before. You get old guys say this kind of stuff quite a lot, and it's not just an old codger reminiscing. I'm actually saying it because I recognise the signs. I've seen them before. I can actually smell the blood in the water. So I think we're not on the crest of the wave right now, but we are actually entering a period of great opportunity for investment in construction technology. And I can say that having benefited from it myself over the years. So let me explain. I'm going to start with a little bit of ancient history for you. Because it is relevant. It's very UK-centric, which is ironic, because most of my businesses have been pan-European. My last business was based in Munich. But some stuff from the UK. Back in 1994, a chap called Sir Michael Latham was asked by UK government to write a report about why the construction industry was failing. He wrote a report, and it was called Constructing the Team. And in it, he identified a raft of systemic failings in the industry. And he condemned existing practices as adversarial, ineffective, and fragmented. And it caused quite a stir at the time. I remember it well. As a side note, Michael eventually became the chairman of my company, BRW. So God rest his soul, he died last year, but a wonderful man. 4 years later, 20 years ago, this year, 1998, another chap, Sir John Egan, wrote a report called Rethinking Construction. Sounds familiar, young reviewer. You've plagiarised that one. What John Egan's report said was, there's quite a lot of stuff that construction needs to learn from manufacturing, because those guys do it really well. And outcomes for clients in the construction industry and for all parties are universally poor. The thing that was interesting about it, because a lot of the subject matter was the same actually, but both of those reports spawned lots of government-backed inquiries, reports, initiatives, committees, many of which I was actually involved with. But the thing that was really interesting for me was they both spawned a feeding frenzy for construction technology providers, which I have benefited from. And why is that relevant now? Well, I think the collapse of Korea, and whilst there have been lots of speculation about why they collapsed and all that stuff, the thing that's interesting is what's going to happen about that, the driver behind that, or more specifically, what government they're going to do about it, because they've got quite a lot of egg on their face. And I think what's going to happen is it's going to produce a lot more reports and inquiries and legislation. And that's going to create some gaps that these new guys, the new technology providers, can fill with the technology that can meet the requirements that couldn't be met by the old technologies that currently are in place. So what is the current state of the art? Just my perspective. And I say this as a chap with a significant stake in a construction ERP vendor. ERP doesn't work in construction. It never did, and it never will. And there's lots of reasons for that. Step back. So what have companies got right now? Most construction companies have got some back office systems, some accounting systems. They erroneously call them ERP. I don't subscribe to that view. And they've got an eclectic mix of operational software that sits around that, you know, estimating systems, project management, various different collaborative tools. The CFO of a large construction company, recently defunct, described them to me as barnacle systems. I think that's quite nicely. So the current state of the art for those systems, though, is that they're typically on-premise, they're typically supplied by companies that are 20 or 30 years old, They don't integrate with anything else. They don't share data with anything else. They're not really part of the strategy. They've usually been brought in by some chap that worked in a business that was acquired, or somebody's particular preference, or some, you know, project director's favourite tool set. Now, in theory, ERP, because of its integrated nature, would go some way to address that. And it's a question I often get asked, why doesn't, you know, Oracle just come in and resolve this problem? And the reality of it is that in the 30 or so years, I know I don't look it, by the way, that I've been doing this, I can't really remember any massive success stories from implementing large-scale ERP systems, but I can actually remember quite a few horror stories. So, and why is that? And the nub of the problem, in my view, is that most construction companies, big and small, if they're run really, really, really well, they operate on 2 or 3% net margins. So they just don't have the wherewithal to do it. There's your problem. So also, underlying that, notwithstanding what other speakers have said, construction businesses are in reality made up of lots of individuals from different companies, divisions, sections, private fiefdoms, special purpose vehicles, and all these guys who've never worked together before have to come together on a project and work harmoniously to deliver an outcome. Now, if you've got a great big project that's going to go on for 2 or 3 years, it's probably worth trying to achieve some kind of level playing field across that. It's actually very hard to do on a day-to-day basis. Back to my earlier point, when you're operating on 2 or 3% net margins, you just don't have the resources in the company to train everybody, get everybody working together, to do all that stuff that other industries can do. So clearly, a different approach is needed. And that's one that can be implemented incrementally, doesn't demand process conformity across the entire piece, is very light touch, and I mean no training, no support, no implementation, no configuration, all that stuff. And I say no as a goal, as kind of an aspiration. I don't think we're there yet. But most importantly, and a number of the speakers have picked this up, and I'm very glad that they did, one that can contribute to the big picture view without having to be supplied by the same supplier. So that whole integration piece is absolutely key. I mentor a thing called the Accelerator Academy, where each semester we get, you know, 10 or 12 young entrepreneurs. They've all developed an app for something or other. But the thing that's interesting to me is that the app is usually for something very specific. Oh, two speakers go, probably name Wally Thomas, isn't it? Was saying, yeah, what you've got to do is narrow it down, be specific about what you're going to provide. So the apps that I'm seeing do something, a specific thing, and they do it really, really well. And it struck me in the process of all that lot that if you could string that lot together, rather like a string of pearls, you'd end up with a fantastic scalable architecture that means that you could have an entirely different approach. So now when I'm asked by construction companies, should they implement a massive review and chuck everything out and replace it with, you know, insert large system? I'm not going to say Oracle because they've given me quite a lot of money lately. So, but something like that. What I say to them is, my view would be, keep your back office systems, keep your accounting systems, chop off all the bits that you've modified and made bespoke around them, and revert it back to its core. Make that really solid, and then surround that with sharp, fabulous, new, light, agile applications that you can buy from all these young folks who've got massive brains and endless energy and that are going to come up with something completely different. And you do that for the tools that are in the doing the work part of the business, the bit that makes the money or loses the money. And I think that's the way forward. That's kind of what I really see. So my advice to whoever in construction companies is responsible for buying all that stuff would be, do all of that, but have some kind of strategy for integration, some kind of framework for integration. That's a real key to all this stuff. Bring it all together, empower your project teams, and let them choose the right tools for the job. Klaus said to me earlier, to talk about what I think's happening in the value chain. Well, here's the awful truth. The awful truth is that a few well-run firms are doing all right, and the rest of them are just surviving. That's a fact. Very much the case in the UK. When I was in Germany, it was much the case throughout most of the European countries in which I've worked. I don't think this is because projects are being mismanaged or that they need greater efficiency, although heaven knows they do, and I think there's a lot of gains in all that lot. I actually think it's because the funding model for the construction industry generally is broken, horribly broken, actually. So even in government projects, the reality of the finance is that it's the bottom tier of the supply chain that work for 120 days or 150 days before getting paid. So in effect, they are creating, delivering the working capital for construction projects. And the problem with that is that those are the guys that have got the worst credit ratings. So the reality of construction projects is they're being funded at two or three times the market rate. So, where's Perry? A couple of years ago, we did a survey. Construction News spoke to loads of subcontractors and said to them, thing number one, how much do you load your prices by to account for the fact that you're probably not going to get paid for ages? And the average on that was just under 5%, actually. And we then said the question the other way around and said, well, if you got paid in 30 days, how much would you discount by? And that averaged out 2%, right? So right there, there's a bunch of money that's sloshing around in the industry that's currently wasted. So perversely, despite my comments about the industry having very poor margins, I actually think there's a bit of fat in it if we can start to address some of those issues. So where's the industry heading? I was watching the telly this morning very early. BBC had an article on about the fact that in lots of regional cities, construction activity is up. Great, that's great news. Sad fact of that, of course, is that will send more companies bust than there being a lack of work, because it's overtrading and usually kills them. I think that Carillion and Grenfell, that they are going to generate shockwaves. As I said earlier, those shockwaves are going to generate a raft of initiatives and reports and committees and probably new legislation and probably a requirement for more transparency. I think we've probably heard the death knell of PFIs. If Corbyn gets in, who knows what will happen. I think house building will continue at a pace, although I rather suspect that house building CEOs are going to get smaller bonuses in future years. I think that's become a bit of a hot topic. Just did my own tax return, that's pretty painful. So, and I also think project bank accounts, by the way, that seems to be the universal anecdote of all cash flow issues wanted by various soothsayers in the industry. My own view is it solves some problems and creates a whole bunch of new problems. But very interestingly, all of that stuff creates some great opportunities for the technology providers. So what are the technologies that can make a difference? Well, cloud and SaaS, obviously, we're all kind of well bought into that idea. I think that fits well with the CapEx requirements of construction projects. You know, you've only got to look in the skips outside of a construction project and you'll see that project level spending isn't very well controlled. You know, there's thousands of pounds worth of stuff in there that got chopped off at places where it didn't really fit to transfer to you. So I kind of like the idea of SaaS. I think it's more equitable. I think there'll be lots of suppliers focused on solving specific business problems. Textura was a great example of that. The only thing Textura did was speed up the process between the subcontractor raising his application for payment and getting paid. So that's one tiny process amidst thousands of processes. It's close to the cash, so my advice for anybody writing software would be get close to the cash, because obviously that's where the cash is. Textura with 100 million of revenues got sold for $663 million, and I think was undervalued. I genuinely believe that, not just because I got some of it, but because it was worth more. It's a fabulous business. It's got to be light touch, it's got to be easy integration. Anyone writing software now, other speakers have said this, write it with a view to sharing that data with other pearls in the chain. That said, so those are the general characteristics. Things I think are interesting. Blockchain, I think, is for me a very interesting technology. It allows developers to create decentralized apps with absolute security and transparency. Surely to goodness that is needed. Internet of Things, we talked about that a bit before. I'm very interested in that. I'm very interested in its ability to allow objects to check themselves in and out on hire off site, all that kind of stuff, taking some facts out of the industry. I was speaking earlier with Barry. I'm particularly interested in AI. I've got some investments in other businesses. I've got an investment in a business that uses AI to sift out the sheep from the goats in your emails. And I think in construction, that could be tremendously valuable if software could automate some of those repetitive tasks, classify information better, start to say what if, take away some of the human error opportunities, create some more consistency and conformity. Final note, because I'm getting waved at. One lesson I have learned, I spent a couple of £1 million a few years ago building a product called Planweaver, and it was brilliant, and it's all about a clever way of optimising processes in construction. Everyone that saw it said that it would revolutionise construction, and absolutely nobody would give me any money for it. And that's because it was slightly too far ahead of the curve. So in construction especially, because it's a conservative industry, what we need to do is put the carrot just slightly in front of the nose and drag people through in that respect. But with that, with those thoughts in mind, if you're an investor, I'm investing in the construction industry or construction technology suppliers. Now's the time to do it, guys, because there's going to be winners and losers that emerge over the next few years. Okay.